to a Wonderful Life, coming to you live from Palm Springs, California. And our Way to a Wonderful Life message for today is titled, Take Nothing for the Journey. Take nothing for the journey. And we're going to go to some words from the Holy Bible, from the Gospel of Luke. And this is attributed to Jesus from Luke 9, 3 through 5. He told them, take nothing for the journey. No staff, no bag, no bread, no money, no extra shirt. Whatever house you enter, stay there until you leave that town. If people do not welcome you, leave their town and shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. That's from Jesus in the Holy Bible, Gospel of Luke 9, 3 through 5. And each and every one of us can realize a greater good as we take time to understand these words of the mastermind Jesus, take nothing for the journey. And by this we know what he meant. We are to loose our mind of the old thoughts and the old ideas that no longer serve us or benefit us, and open our mind to the new, the greater, and the more appealing. And this means that we have to leave behind the old images of ourselves that we have accepted from the world, and accept within our mind a greater power, a greater wisdom, and a greater ability to demonstrate the life that we hope for, dream about, and pray for. Now, many of us continue to live in a comfort zone. That is, we are comfortable with our way of life, but since the Spirit is always seeking to express itself through us in a greater, more expansive way, this comfort zone state of mind can cause frustration, anxiousness, dissatisfaction, and for some people, depression. Jesus taught that we are to resist not evil, but for most of us, this is not a problem. It is the resisting our good that causes us to become uncomfortable. The Spirit is always seeking to enjoy life through us in new ways, always bringing to our awareness through our thoughts, our dreams, or the things that get our attention, something new for us to do, something new for us to be, or something new for us to have. If nothing else, a new state of mind, a new way of looking at life and looking at our place in the universe. We are the life of the Spirit in human form, and the Spirit is infinite and infinite in its seeking newness through us. This newness can be as simple as the idea for a new dress that appeals to us, or the idea to shave our face less and grow a beard, or as life-changing as moving to a new city, beginning a new career, or ending a relationship. Every new idea, every new thought is originating from the Spirit, weaving its way through our mind, our heart, and our soul. It is, of course, the life-changing ideas that stop many of us. This is where not only our faith comes into play, but also our confidence in the guidance of Spirit. For so many people, we want to know exactly what's going to happen. We fear uncertainty. We fear uncertainty because we have not learned to be totally reliant on the goodness of God, the truth that all things work to our good. When our mind is stayed on the good, when our mind is stayed on God, aligned with the wisdom and the Spirit and the intelligence of God. And the two areas of our life where this occurs the most is our work or careers and our relationships. The mastermind Jesus put it this way, if people do not welcome you, leave their town and shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. And what does he mean by leave their town? He means leave that consciousness that doesn't have the awareness of how important you are, that the potentials within you or that ability within you to do the greater thing. In other words, if people do not respect our consciousness, we must leave. We are not here to live to less than who we are, but to be valued and supported in our good. Many people struggle in relationships that are unhappy, that are discordant, and even demeaning. And many people struggle for success and prosperity in jobs that do not compensate them fairly or support them in their goals and ambition. The mastermind Jesus is telling us to leave them and forget them. Shake the dust off your feet, he said, and that means to eliminate these things from our consciousness. Instead, we are to establish in our consciousness the faith and confidence that dispels the fear, dispels the concern about making a life-changing decision, and make the decision and make a commitment to it. As the great Dr. Bitzer taught, If we are not finding success where we are not in our right place. If we are not finding success where we are not in our right place. And by that right place, he means we're not surrounding ourselves with the consciousness that supports us in doing the greater things, whether it's a relationship or whether it's a place where we work or even a church. Sometimes churches, you know, churches can be hard places for people to get along because the people do not support them in the newness and evolving the ideas of their relationship with God, their relationship to life. And so we know that we must find that consciousness if we're going to be in our right place and live with success and health and happiness and prosperity. And by success, Dr. Bitzer means happiness, peace of mind, prosperity, and creative expression. If the people around us do not recognize our consciousness and therefore do not recognize our value or worth, then we are not to resist them, but make the decision and stick to it and move on. Move on. Bless them where they are and move on first in consciousness and then in the physical if necessary. Let's look at these words from the great Dr. Raymond Charles Barker. This is from his book, The Power of Decision. He tells us, say this to yourself. See if you can believe these words as the truth for you. I am pure intelligence, always acting intelligently. If you can say this without the subconscious rejection of the fact, in other words, if you can say it with a full faith and conviction, you are well along on the pathway of spiritual understanding. If the central idea involved here causes no conflict in your acceptance of yourself as intelligence, then you are ready to live effectively. We cannot go beyond our own self-accepted image. We cannot go beyond our own self-accepted image. As long as we underestimate ourselves, we cannot succeed in life. No person is stupid. Stupidity is only a misuse of intelligence in non-intelligent ways. Everyone, including you and me, is mind or spirit in action, with the potentials of greatness awaiting our demand that they shall come forth out of the depths of consciousness and begin creative action. In other words, when we affirm and say that I know the answer, I know the right idea for me, I know that I can be guided and directed to the right place for me, then that becomes our truth. And soon enough, we're there. Soon enough, we find it. Soon enough, we come into unity with it. And we find ourselves living that greater life, that more abundant life, that more wonderful life. Dr. Barker writes, if you can say this without subconscious rejection of the fact, that is, we must know that intelligence is actively intelligent within our own mind. Not within our brain, but within our own mind. Otherwise, doubt will obstruct our ability to make decisions and choices that lead us into the awareness that something greater that we desire to experience, that obstruct us, that doesn't bring it to our awareness. We don't even realize that there's more for us to have, more for us to be, more for us to do if we allow ourselves to obstruct the intelligence, which is God, which is spirit, which is power, seeking to express that idea through us. Once we make a decision and fully commit to it, that something that we call God, Infinite Spirit, through law and love, moves heaven and earth to support us in our decision. And by this, I don't mean intervention, but through the law of attraction, through the law of sowing and reaping, all people and all things necessary for us to achieve that which we have made the decision to achieve will show up. Through love, that is the givingness of the Spirit, the awareness of what to do and how to do it, becomes our reality. That which I am to do best, only my Maker can teach me, said the great Emerson. And these powerful words are the truth for every one of us. But God cannot make a decision for us. We must make our own decisions, and we must make our own commitments to these decisions. God works through these activities in our mind, for us, and through us, always responding by corresponding to that which we believe to be true, to that which we accept for ourselves. Our question then is, do we resolve to move on? Do we resolve to move on and to be more, to have more, to experience more of the good that the divine has prepared for us? Are we ready to accept that the desires of our heart are God's desires for us? Are we ready to accept that? Are we ready to make a commitment to the choices and decisions that are ours and ours alone to make? That's always the question. The great Wallace D. Wattles wrote in his 1910 classic book, The Science of Getting Rich, it requires power to think health when surrounded by the appearances of disease, or to think riches when in the midst of the appearances of poverty. But he who acquires this power becomes a mastermind, and that power is the faith within us. He can conquer fate. He can have what he wants. This power can only be acquired by getting hold of the basic fact, which is behind all appearances, that is behind all things material, that there is a thinking substance from which and by which all things are made, but it must be allowed to think through us. Then we must grasp the truth that every thought held in the substance becomes a form, and that a person can impress their thoughts upon it so as to cause them to take form and become visible things. In other words, that's why we're cautioned in the scriptures to pray without ceasing. To pray without ceasing means to keep affirming that God is. Keep recognizing that God is. Keep knowing that there's something within you that's greater that comes to your mind, comes to your awareness through desires, those desires of the Father they are. D means of, and sire means Father, or of the Father, of the Spirit. As Jesus said, the Father is a Spirit, and we must worship him, Jesus said, in spirit and in truth. In other words, get enthusiastic about those good desires that come into your mind to be more, to have more, to do more, even if that more is only to change your physical appearance, even if that new idea is only to visit parts of the city in which you live or the town in which you live and see something different, go to a new restaurant, find yourself guided and being around different people so that you get a different feeling of this infinite universe in which we live and how much is available to us to experience. We're here to experience this life. God clothed our spirit in human form so that we could experience life in a greater way. We could experience life as who we are, as the reality of spirit having a human experience. The reality of spirit having a human experience. Jesus said, let me show you the way. Follow me, he said. Follow me, do as I do, believe as I believe. Know God as I know God. Know that God is always closer to us than breathing, nearer than hands and feet. So he told them, you want to know something, you want to feel something better, experience something better, have something better, do something better, grow into a greater potential of life, then take nothing for the journey. No staff, no bag, no bread, no money, no extra shirt, depend on nothing. Whatever house you enter, whatever consciousness you enter into, stay there until you leave that town. Stay there until it no longer serves you, and just know that sometimes things just come for a season. They didn't come to stay. They only came for a season. So let them go and move on. If people do not welcome you, he said, leave their town. Leave that consciousness that you've arrived at and shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against that and say, that's not for me. I want something better. I want something more. I want something greater. I desire to live that abundant life, that good life, that wonderful life. And I'm going to make a commitment within myself, within my own mind, to do just that. To do just that. And as we do that, then we will find ourselves guided and directed to that greater thing. Let's go back to those words of the great Dr. Raymond Charles Barker. Once again, this is from his book, The Power of Decision. He says, I am, can you say this? I am pure intelligence, always acting intelligently. That means that we're a part of God. We're the image, likeness of God. I am pure intelligence means I am that intelligence, that power, that spirit of God. Always acting intelligently, letting God move through my mind, my heart, and my soul to guide me and direct me to that good thing that is mine to do, to be, or to have. If we can say this, he tells us, without rejecting it. Subconscious rejection means that we start pulling back all those old thoughts that said, oh, no, this is too good to be true. You know, nobody I know has done this. You know, I can remember, you know, I was born and raised in a rural part of a little town called Paris, Missouri. And I remember looking back one year, I think it was the 20th anniversary or 25th anniversary of our high school reunion, and I saw where 90% of the people in that class never moved away from that little town. They never moved out and saw any more world in which they had come into being born into. So they had closed themselves off to opportunities and closed themselves off to the newness. And there wouldn't be anything wrong in staying where you are. But get out. Go see the world. Go travel. See the things that God has created. Get out and see the mountains and see the ocean. See all the things from Paris, Missouri. Believe me, there's no mountains and there's no ocean. So I've got to tell you, the only way to do it would be to travel. So it says, I am pure intelligence, always acting intelligently, always giving God full reign in my mind to bring to me ideas, to bring to me the visions of being and doing and having things that create a more abundant life, a more wonderful life. But he said, if we can say this, I am pure intelligence, I am that image, likeness of God, always acting intelligently. If we can say this without subconscious rejection of the fact, we are well along on the pathway of spiritual understanding. If the central idea involved here causes no conflict in our acceptance of ourselves as intelligence, then we are ready to live more effectively. We cannot go beyond our own self-accepted image. That's the absolute truth. We cannot. We cannot. As long as we underestimate ourselves, we cannot succeed in life. No person is stupid. No person is weak. Stupidity and weakness is only a misuse of intelligence in non-intelligent ways. Everyone, including you and me, is spirit, the mind of the spirit in action, with the potentials of greatness awaiting our demand that they shall come forth out of the depths of our consciousness and begin creative action. Can we believe that? Can we accept that in our mind as the truth for us, because we're the only ones that can accept it? No one else can accept it for us. It's up to us to decide, is this the truth about me? And if this is the truth about me, then I must say to myself, these good desires that have come to my awareness, that yes, indeed, they are God's good desires for me, and I shall move forward, advance forward towards them with faith and conviction, and just allow myself to experience this thing called life in a greater way. So let's go back and look at these words from Wallace D. Wattles. Once again, this is from his classic 1910 book, The Science of Getting Rich. And let's take these words into our mind and say, how does this work for me in my life? How can I take this into a practical in a practical way into my experience? Am I looking to get a promotion at work? Am I looking to get an increase in compensation? Am I looking to get an increase in my work? Am I looking to have an increase of love and harmony in my relationships? Am I looking for more love, more happiness, more peace, more health? What is it that I'm looking for? I can have it, but I've got to make the decision to have it. So Wallace D. Wattles writes, it requires power to think health when surrounded by the appearances of disease, or to think riches when in the midst of the appearances of poverty. But he who acquires this power becomes a mastermind. He can conquer fate. He can have what he wants. This power can only be acquired by getting hold of the basic fact, which is behind all appearances, that there is a thinking substance that's intelligent from God, from which and by which all things are made. Then we must grasp the truth that every thought held in this substance begins to shape and form something that we can impress upon our thoughts upon it and cause it to bring that form into visibility, to bring the invisible into the visible. We can do it. That power is faith within us. That power is that deep inner knowing that God is, that God is always right where we are, that God is always available, that the intelligence is. As we read in the scriptures, the primitive people told us that in Him we live and move and have our being. And that Him was referring to the Father that Jesus referred to, and Jesus said the Father is a spirit. So in the spirit we live and move and have our being. No one doubts that we're surrounded by the air that we breathe. No one doubts that the air is above us, below us, pressing against us. It flows through us as we inhale. It goes out from us as we exhale. And we know that through faith and confidence, we can draw more air into our lungs and into our bloodstream by inhaling again. No one doubts that. But people doubt the invisibility of the presence of God, the presence of this intelligence that rules everything, this ultimate supreme power, spirit. An intelligence that rules all and guides all through love and law is right here, right where we are. In Him we live, in this spirit, in this intelligence, in this power. We live and move and have our being. And we can go the next step further and say, in me, God desires to experience something greater. God desires to experience the good and more good. So as I leave all the old nonsense behind, that old belief that it's too good to be true, or that life is hard and then you die, or all that other stuff that tells me that God helps those who help themselves, and let that be the old truth, let that be the old lie that we give up, and realize that God helps those who let Him, and let the Spirit reign supreme in your mind, your heart, and your soul to faith, and we can see these things come into our life in a greater way. If we don't love what we do and love what we who we are doing it, if we don't love what we do and love who we are doing it, then it is our time to resolve to move on. And as Dr. Barker writes, everyone is mind, spirit, and action with the potential for greatness awaiting our demand, that they shall come forth out of the depths of consciousness and begin creative action. We have the power of decision always, but we must leave behind all the doubts and the worries and the fears. As Jesus said, take nothing for the journey but faith and hope and a reliance that God is. God is our all in all. God is our everything. And know that in God we live and move and have our being. And in us, God desires to experience that good idea, that good desire that comes to our mind. And as we find that appeal for it in our heart, and we find that truth, the truth about it, that truth about it believed in our soul, and keep faith with it, we shall realize it beginning right now, right where we are. So once again, I want to thank you for being with me today. It's been my great pleasure.